really intimately collaborated with two major professors at Stanford in very different disciplines. That was one of the attractive things about Stanford. The entire campus, everyone is together. The medical school is across the street from us, which is usually not the case. The medical people very far away from the chemists. And that was Joshua Lederberg, who became a very close friend of mine, who at that time was the chair of genetics, but he's an absolute genius with interest in many other areas. And the other one is Ed Feigenbaum, who was at that time the chair of computer sciences. And Ed Feigenbaum is one of the pioneers of artificial intelligence. Joshua Lederberg, who knows everything, was, among other things, very much interested in exobiology, namely life in outer space, and was involved in some of the preliminary work on some of the NASA missions at the time, and is still focused on unmanned exploratory things, and therefore wanted to develop methods of detecting natural products if they existed on Mars and on the Moon by methods which had all have to be spectroscopic. And Feigenbaum, well, he and Feigenbaum got together and realized that there's a lot of computer stuff that has to get involved in this, because then it's only through telemetry and computer interpretation that you can go and analyze these data. And then became interested, it was just the beginning of artificial intelligence. And as I said, Ed Feigenbaum was one of the pioneers in this, and first started collaborating with Joshua Lederberg about this. And a couple of years later approached me and said, how about using it in chemistry? And we'll use you as an example and say, well, let the computer learn how Carl Djerassi thinks. And let's see whether we can put that into program language. And that led to a series of papers. We probably published something in the order of 40 papers in this, which had always the title Application of Artificial Intelligence to Organic Chemistry. Became very interesting. So we did an awful lot of work on this as well, and computerized even the structure elucidation of natural products, which are then used very much pedagogically. And I'll explain this in a very amusing experiment illustration. The manner in which an organic chemist thinks, even to this day, when he doesn't do any chemistry anymore, but only use spectroscopic methods, when he wants to arrive at the chemical structure of the compound and say, you know, this is the structure of the compound, this here. And you can see this has nothing to do now with steroids, looks very different. Or this, the chemical structure. Well, you know, you don't see it, you don't have it in your hands. You infer it. And what you're doing is you draw up straw men, alternative ones that are consistent with the data. And then you try and find a piece of datum. Data was a plural, a piece of datum that eliminates one but not the other. And eventually what you do is you kill all the other straw men, you're left with only one, but he's still a straw man in a way. Although emotionally you're convinced, logical, that really exists. But you don't really know that. You will only know this under two conditions. Either if you actually then make it unambiguously, and therefore then you've confirmed it, because then you have it in your hand, so to speak, or you take a flash picture, an x-ray picture, which shows you there it is, even though you don't have it, but there it is. Well, the computer, while it can't think completely by himself, and I purposely always visualize him as a man, as a dull man, and not really as a sexy woman, is the computer can operate much faster than you can, although the fundamental thing is maybe a different proposition. So the computer can analyze all the data that you have and compare them with the straw man that you have drawn up. It can do more than that. It can create straw men, all the straw men that are consistent with the data that you have. And it turns out that almost always the computer can think of more straw men than you can, which is something which is humbling and also quite interesting. Now, when you do that, and so he comes with some more ideas that you didn't have, but then he draws pictures, theoretical ones. And then, of course, I, the intelligent chemist, can say, ah, but I could devise a method which will separate that new straw man from the other one, and eventually you still reduce it to only one. But by having the confidence that the computer came up with all possible straw men, by reducing to only one, then I think you're there. So I used that in an advanced course in chemistry with graduate students, where basically we taught them how to use that software program. And then say, you go into the literature, each of you pick on your own a different paper that's been published by different people, which purports to describe the chemical structure of a new natural product, sometimes quite complicated, where they then publish and say, this is it, proudly. And now take all these data which are described in there and put them in the program and tell the computer, can you think of any other straw man? Well, it turns out in every paper, the computer thought of at least one more, but in some cases, many as 40 more. And then I said, now write to these authors who happen to be in many different countries and say, dear Dr. So-and-so, you published this paper that the structure of compound XYZ is this, but I'm afraid your data are also consistent with this, this, this. Well, this is really terrible. But you write this to a person. You either take it as an insult, or you take it, you know, as a wound, or you are horrified and so on. And there were three kinds of responses that they got. From some, they never got a response at all. They just didn't even want to hear about it. They were all said, would you send me that program? I'm fascinated. I'd like to use this. And the others, the third one, that was the most interesting and amusing one, said, ah, yeah, very interesting. But of course, this is not possible, the one that the computer sent, because we have another piece of information that excludes it. And they did have it, but they didn't publish it. And that is an important thing. In other words, their rigorous analytical process was not really systematic and rigorous. They happened to find little driblets that said, oh yeah, but this we had found somewhere else, and that excludes this one and so on. And that is very, very useful. And that really, we had made quite a contribution in the 60s or 70s and even 80s. And in this particular area, which was sort of the last physical method, you might say, that we employed in there.